Welcome back, folks. So today we're going to talk about how to calculate iterated integrals in the case that it might be easier to use polar coordinates to describe the region of integration than it is to use Cartesian coordinates to describe the region of integration. And this is especially useful in the case that your region happens to be circular or semicircular. If you think about having to write the limits using Cartesian coordinates, then you'd have to rely on equations and circles and things like that. You know, here this is just a quick example to motivate us. And looking already at these limits of integration, anytime a square root with a complicated radicand comes into the game, I can already anticipate that integrating something that contains a quantity like this is going to be a huge pain. So polar coordinates enter as a way to turn these very difficult and complicated limits of integration into limits that are significantly easier and simpler to work with. Our goals for today are just to briefly review the conversion between Cartesian and polar coordinates and how they can be used to describe regions. Then we're going to briefly review how to rewrite a function of x and y as a function of r and theta instead. And then we're going to be rewriting some simple double integrals using polar coordinates instead of Cartesian coordinates and using them to find some volumes. So let's get started. So first of all, polar coordinates are represented by the two numbers r and theta. R represents the distance from the origin, and theta represents the angle with the positive x-axis. Measured counterclockwise. So for example, if I have a point situated, say, here in the xy plane, then r would be the distance from that point to the origin, and theta would be the angle made with the positive x-axis measured counterclockwise from the positive x-axis. Now, we have some common conversion formulas from polar to Cartesian and back again. X can be written as r cosine theta, y can be thought of as r sine theta, and if you encounter x squared plus y squared, that can always be replaced with r squared. So these three formulas are the ones that we'll be using the most often when we go ahead and use polar coordinates instead of Cartesian coordinates in this class. Now let's just do a quick exercise. Use polar coordinates to describe the following region R. The quarter of the disk consisting of x squared plus y squared is less than or equal to 16, occupying quadrant 1. So let's draw this region. We have the quarter of the disk of radius 4 that occupies region 1. So amidst all the points in this disk, the radius can vary from 0 here at the origin, and at its largest, the radius can be 4, which is on the rim of the disk. Whoops, 4. And if I think about the permitted values of theta can go from theta equals 0 here on the positive x-axis itself, all the way up to theta equals pi half, which would correspond to the positive y-axis. Theta less than or equal to pi over 2. So just a quick review of polar coordinates as used to describe regions in two dimensions. Now let's get to the good stuff. Suppose that we wanted to rewrite the following integral to find the volume between the surfaces z equals 9 and z equals x squared plus y squared. Now, if we were going to do this in Cartesian coordinates, let's see what would be involved. The first thing that I would need to do is I would need to establish which one of these functions is larger than the other. Now, we've encountered z equals x squared plus y squared a few times now. This function is a paraboloid. When x is 0 and y is 0, the output is also 0. And it looks like a bowl that's opening up. Now, z equals 9. Z equals 9, that is just a flat plane where no matter what x value, no matter what y value you plug in, the z value that comes out is always 9. And so our goal is to find the region between the paraboloid on the bottom and the plane on the top. Okay. Now let's try and think about the region of integration that we should use. Region of integration. Since we're trying to find the volume between these two, and a specific region has not been given to us, let's try and figure out where the paraboloid and the plane intersect each other. This will give us an idea of where we should stop calculating the integral. So let's see if we can figure out where z equals 9 crosses z equals x squared plus y squared, so we can get a sense of what space this volume occupies, indicated in pink, the pink disk that's drawn here in the image. So I'll solve z equals 9 equals 9 squared plus y squared. And so the plane and the paraboloid intersect on the circle of radius 3. So the region of integration that I'll need to consider are all the points x, y, so that x and y are contained in this circle of radius 3. So I'm drawing in that disk in pink down here on the xy plane. This is the region corresponding to the volume between the plane at z equals 9 and the paraboloid underneath it. R is the disk where x squared plus y squared is less than or equal to 9. But now if I draw this region of integration, we're in this situation of having an upper limit of y equals negative square root of x minus y squared, the upper half of this circle of radius 3, and a lower limit that's just as bad. And I shudder to think of an integral that involves quantities, square rooted quantities, that are as complicated as these two. So instead, we're going to develop a technique that we can use to set up iterated integrals in polar coordinates instead, because it's going to make it much easier to describe limits of integration corresponding to circle-shaped or disk-shaped regions like these. So here's the formula that we'll use. Let R be a region inside the xy plane. And let's suppose that it's bounded on the outside by the polar function r equals function of theta. And it's bounded on the inside by the polar function r equals function of theta. Four theta values valid for alpha to beta. Now let me do a little sketch to show what's going on. We're going to have some curve which is far away from the origin. Let me clean it up just a little bit. Something like this. Some curve which is far from the origin. This is the outer function, r equals h of theta. Then we're going to have some curve which is closer to the origin. This is r equals g of theta. And we're going to be considering these two functions for values of theta between some lower angle, theta equals alpha, and some upper angle, theta equals beta. And the region of integration will be the one trapped between all these different functions here. If your region can be described simply by between all these different polar functions, then you can rewrite your double integral as an iterated integral in the following way. We start with two integration symbols, as usual. Now, on the bottom of the inner integral, we're going to have the inner radius, the lower radius. And on the top, we're going to have the higher radius function. And we traditionally, perhaps always, integrate with respect to r first. Then, outermost limit of integration is theta, and theta is going between the angle alpha at its lowest and the angle beta at its highest. Then you're going to come in and integrate your function, but it doesn't make sense to use the variables x and y, because x and y don't have anything to do with your limits. So instead, replace r with its polar equivalent, r cosine theta, and replace y with its polar equivalent, r sine theta. But that's not all. When you write a polar function, iterated integral in polar coordinates, there's one more thing to add to your integrand, and that is an extra copy of r. If you want to rewrite an iterated integral in polar coordinates, set up appropriate theta and r limits, change your function so that it's in polar coordinates, and then multiply by r. Let's demonstrate what we mean with this motivating example. We established that the region r over which we were integrating had the shape of a circle of radius 3. So let's try and describe the region R in polar coordinates. In polar coordinates, the outermost radius is a constant radius. The outer radius is always R equals 3. And that radius can go all the way from R equals 3 into the center of the disk. The inner radius is r equals 0. Now, to fill out the entire disk, our theta values should go from theta equals 0, positive x-axis, and wrap all the way around to theta equals 2 pi, bringing us back to the positive x-axis. So theta here, since we have the entire circle, stretches between 0 and 2 pi. So let's integrate. R goes from 0 to 3, theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, first with respect to r, and then with respect to theta. Top function, 9, minus bottom function, x squared plus y squared. Recalling our drawing from the motivating example, that the paraboloid, the x squared plus y squared function, was the one on the bottom, and z equals 9 was the function on the top. But this that we have written so far is incomplete and inaccurate in many ways. The first thing that's wrong about this is that we have forgotten, essentially, we have forgotten that when we set up a polar integral, that we need to add manually an extra factor of r. So let's multiply this entire quantity by r, an extra r in the integrand. Not only that, but we need to make sure that we eliminate from our integrand any occurrence of Cartesian coordinates x and y. So x squared y squared is not allowed, and we are going to have to replace that with its polar equivalent, r squared. So having converted everything to polar coordinates, the limits of integration are in polar, the integrand is in polar, we've added that mandatory extra r for polar integrals. Let's go ahead and actually do the calculation. Beginning by distributing and simplifying 9r minus r cubed. So now let's integrate this quantity with respect to r, treating the outer variable theta as the constant. We have the integral from 0 to 2 pi. We have 9 over 2 r squared. We have 1/4 r to the 4th power integrated, evaluated from 0 to 3. Now plugging in r equals 0 will cause each of these terms to vanish. So let's plug in r equals 3. And we have 3 times 3 times 9, 81 over 2. 3 cubed is also 81. So we are integrating 81 over 4 from 0 to pi with respect to theta. Now, treating theta as the variable of integration, we have 81 over 4 times theta, evaluated from 0 to 2 pi, which gives us a final answer of 81 over 4 times 2 pi, or 81 pi over 2, if you prefer.